So today I'm going to give a progress report about our interest in the developing functional DNA fluorescein and colorimetric sensors for heavy metal ions as well as the endotoxin. So as we all know that we have a lot of challenges in terms of natural resources availability. One of the grand challenges is the on-site real-time detection quantification of toxic material. We all know that to make a sustainable future, and we need to, first of all, we need to know how much is material there, particularly including the heavy metal and the toxin, but these are some of the examples that we're interested in. Before we want to have effort to remediate those toxic materials, we have to know how much they are and where they are. And also during the remediation process, also need to monitor the progress. Our technology is working or not, how much is working. So we still also need on-site real-time detection. But even after remediation, after successfully done, we still need to continue monitoring to see whether this kind of resources are continuing in the top shape or not. So therefore, in my opinion, the on-site real-time detection quantification really at every single step of sustainable future and resources for natural resources. But on the other hand, of course, it's not trivial. There's a number of different scientific challenges and issues. Because most of these toxin materials, for example, metal ions and toxins, are very large in number. This is just to give you a priority table. As you all know, there are many of them are beneficial, but a number are also quite toxic, particularly, for example, metal ions and organic toxins. So there are also very subtle structural differences. And you can have, for example, metal ion itself, they all have the same charge. Metal ion have a similar radii, but yet they perform totally different functions. Some of them can be very beneficial. For example, chromium is a good example. Where's chromium? Chromium here, right there. Chromium 3, for example, is a known nutrient for human health, but chromium 6 has been shown to be toxic to human life. So same chromium, but depending on oxidation state, can be one can be beneficial, on the other hand can be toxic. So the subtle differences can be very dramatic different effects, but also very small in quantity. That's the problem. Whether you detect nanomolar or ppb level or lower amount of those materials, not only a large number of different type of toxic material, but also very small in quantity. So we're really facing a challenge, but of course opportunities for technology like ISTC. So it holds a challenge, but also if you can meet the challenge, we'll be presenting opportunity for scientists, but also technology, of course, also in terms of small business. So therefore, that's what we want to take on this the challenges. But again, it's not trivial. Part of the reason, because if you look at it right now on the market, something you can use readily to do on-site real-time detection is not many. But obviously, there are a lot of instruments available. And in fact, I think ICC is probably the leader in instrumental analysis. In fact, we always come here for expertise and for data analysis. We commonly use ICPs and mass spec services in here because they are really represent industry standard. They're very highly sensitive. They detect a number of different targets simultaneously. It's beautiful techniques. But of course, we all know that we also have need to further improve on that because it does require quite expensive equipment, some corporation and people like you, very skilled operators. And therefore, they're relatively difficult for on-site, remote, and real-time detection. So we need complementary techniques. These are the beautiful techniques we need at a center like this. But at the same time, we need something complementary to that so that the users can, for example, can detect them at a home or in a lake or water resource and so on and so forth. So that's really one of the things that we strive to do is to not, absolutely not to replace these techniques, but make these techniques even more useful by having an on-site real-time detection so that we can find something interesting or something serious issue and then can send those samples to the center here for further verification. So I think we need a gap. So one of the primary things that we all know that, a good example is September 11, right? We have a lot of facilities can detect, anthrax or other toxic chemicals. But when you have a powder, when you have a liquid in front of you, you need to make a decision, make a quick decision. So that's what we need to do. And as I mentioned, on the other hand, if you look at the market right now, there are not many such available. There are a fair number of equipment like this, but they may not be able to do it on-site real-time detection. So how can we actually have something that one can use readily at home or even the laboratory, for example, can you actually do some detection and quantification? And we have identified some scientific key steps in terms of making this possible. You know, we all know that we use a pH meter or pH papers all the time. That's really a good primary example of good sensor is about. But unfortunately, there, other than pH meter, pH sensor, there are not many other type of similar devices or papers available for many other solutions. So why are we not seeing more of those? Can we actually, in the near future, have those type of paper for lead, paper for mercury, paper for endotoxin, and stuff like that? Can we do that? So why can't we do that? So pH paper had been discovered actually almost 100 years ago. And I think 1908, if I'm not mistaken, 1900 basically. And then, so why can't we see more of those? I think what we have identified are the four key steps in designing a sensor to realize this dream of paper for a variety of different toxic material or other type of species. So one of the things that the keyword is a general. There are not many general methods allow us, now you have a target of your interest, metal ion or endotoxins. Can you have a general method for obtain a molecule that can bind to the target? And if you think about it, right, most people right now are doing so-called trial and error process. I have a grant, I have a project that contract with NIH or NSF, and if I want to design a molecule to combat lead, I can go in and do the work, and hopefully I can get it. But once that project finished, the idea I can get from that particular process can very difficult to apply to, say, design another molecule. Because every single molecule, as I mentioned in the beginning, is different. There are very subtle structure differences. So one method can be applied successfully in there. For example, pH paper, the same person who designed the pH paper would love to apply the idea from designing pH paper to designing from some other metal ion and then toxin and so on and so forth. But unfortunately, there are not many general methods allowed to obtain molecules for any specific target. And another also much is a key problem or step is there are very few general methods to improve the selectivity. Again, a lot of people have, chemists particularly, have an idea about designing a molecule to bind specifically to another one. But most of the time, they cannot solve the issue of selectivity. It binds to their target somewhat well, but unfortunately find something even better. A good example would be drug discovery, right? Why we have so much trouble take almost $1 billion now to develop, $900 million actually. That's the number I heard about. You know, develop drug from the laboratory to the shelf that you can buy from the doctors. Part of the reason because hundreds of them failed, and only one made it. It's not a single drug cost. It's all the one cost of come all drugs. Why? Because the majority of drugs not selected enough. And also another key scientific challenge is we do have a general method to transform the molecule that combines specific to one or the target to something one can detect, right? You can, in fact, you can see a number of proteins and stuff like that can bind specific to the target, but they're not sensors because they only bind it. You can detect it on the gel or using a radioactive labeled protein to see it, but that's not a sensor. The sensor has to be conveniently, we can detect the signal without compromising the binding affinity as well as the selectivity. And finally, something that has been readily addressed in the sensing area of research, but it's extremely important for practical use. I'm sure the people in this audience appreciate that, is the so-called fine-tune the dynamic range. Because having a sensor that can detect something is only halfway done, but the other one will have to be able to tune the dynamic range so they can match to what interest is about. And I'll give you some examples. And without having a method, again, general method that can solve these four key steps, therefore we do not see, we see a lot of paper, sensor paper published, but very rarely they can be used practically in the laboratory or at home on the shelf that people can buy from the Lowe's or mine. I think these are the really the four scientific challenges what one has to overcome in order one for one can be actually start thinking about utilizing practically, not just publishing paper or something one can do. So I hope I convince you at the end of my talk we have been able to find the method that can generally apply to be able to overcome these four issues. And once we do, we can show you what we can actually show something practical that one can use in the laboratory at home. So let's talk about the first step. Can we have a methodology that can, if you apply one to, say, impact the pH, but also to impact viruses, toxins, metal ions, and other bacteria and cancers and different targets, right? So until recently, there is a method that has been very popular. In fact, you probably see that when you go to the hospital, in the most of the diagnostic basis right now are based on antibodies. Antibody is one of the really powerful methods because it's one of the general methods. Because you have a target, and the immunologist already told us how to do it. So in fact, our body does it automatically, is that they call the antigen. You have a target, either you know, cancer or viruses or something like that. You can use that as an antigen, you can raise antibody against it. Doesn't matter what target it is, they can actually raise against it, have very specific antibody that binds specific to that. So antibody has been extremely powerful. Again, the most diagnostic agents are antibody based. Why is not enough? Part of the reason, if you look carefully, antibody is not very good at sensing small molecules. Antibody is extremely good at recognizing proteins, cells, bacteria, and so on and so forth. But if you look at that, if you look at the field, there's still a significant gap in terms of what antibody can detect. Antibody can detect, cannot detect small molecules like small organic molecules, but also metal ions and so on and so forth. Part of the reason because of immunology, because in order to raise antibody, you need a large enough of molecule shape for the antibody to recognize. In fact, you do you can read the literature, for example, metal ion, to detect raise antibody against metal ion, one had to couple the metal ion to a large organic molecule, and then the antibody can be raised against not to the metal ion, but the metal complexes. But therefore, they lose the selectivity because there are many organic molecules that bind to the metal complexes. Even though antibody can recognize metal complexes, but they cannot selectively detect metal ion itself. So that's one of the things that we are interested in doing in filling this gap, scientific and technology gap, about small molecule detection using antibody. So what we have actually chosen the field has been something only was available in early 1990s, but also started in the 80s, the so-called functional DNA technology. We all know DNA. DNA are genetic storage materials, and RNA are genetic transfer materials. The only difference is 2' hydroxyl here, and they found false in Greek paper. That has been the central dogma for in the biology for many, many years. But that central dogma has been changed a little bit in the early 1980s, and the two Nobel winning discovery was shown that RNA are no longer just genetic transfer materials. They can be enzymes, like proteins, they can catalyze reactions. And but more importantly, in the early 1990s, we discovered that DNA are no longer just genetic storage materials. They can also, like proteins, and they can catalyze reactions. One of the reactions that we're very interested in doing is this. So the DNA only, in the present metal ion, they can actually catalyze a cleavage reaction, something what used to be only protein can do. Now, another biomolecule, both DNA and RNA. But more importantly, at the same time, it was shown that DNA and RNA can also serve like antibodies. They can bind specifically to their target, quite specifically. And in doing so, then they call aptamers, and they have a different shape. In the presence of the target, they can bind very specifically. And then when you combine them together, both DNA and aptamer, you can call them aptamers. Basically, a piece of aptamer can couple to a DNA enzyme that they can put together, they can work together in conjunctionly to form a catalyzed reaction in the presence of this molecular target. So the DNA and aptamer aptamer together are all collected called functional DNA. And why is this the functional DNA so exciting? There are many reasons. Part reason a lot of people are interested in this one because of the origin of life. They may think that protein has been doing a lot of catalytic functions. Now DNA can do it, and DNA may be able to do both catalytic functions and genetic information storage. That may be one of the reasons that, you know, how the life origin comes from. But most importantly, our lab was interested in a particular function in terms of recognition and analytical applications. Part of the reason because these DNA RNA can be selected through this combinatorial biology method. is a very general method, something similar to antibody, where one can actually have a target, something of your interest, metalline, toxins, viruses, and bacteria. One can start with a large DNA library, up to 100 trillion different molecules. We do not know which particular DNA sequences that specifically bind to the target. But in the work done in the early 1990s, it was shown that using this iterated selection, amplification, mutation using PCR, and iteration of that, one can allow it to select a small group of DNA and RNA molecules that are capable of binding specifically to the target where you feed in, and have a Kalita reaction or binding affinity like antibodies. And it's an extremely powerful technique. It can do select amplification, improve each run, and minimal cost, and then short period of time. We're talking about a few days per run, up to 20 runs of selection. And based on that particular technology, one can actually already have demonstrated that this particular technology, just like antibody, one can obtain small DNA and RNA molecules in both metalline, organic molecules, antibiotic, protein enzymes, antibody even all the way to antibody spores. As a small as a small metalline, as big antibody spores. You can see it cover a wide range of molecular targets. It can be, of course, beneficial metalline like magnesium, calcium, but also toxic metalines, beneficial molecules, and also toxic materials, and so on and so forth. Again, unlike antibody, it covers equally well both small molecule space as well as large molecule space. For the large molecule, the binding affinity up to down to picomolar range, just like antibody. In a small molecule case, I'll show you that actually does even better than antibody. So we made a strategic choice in the, many years ago. We do not want to compete. A lot of people have been in this field and aftermarket field have been focusing on competing with antibody. They try to say antibody and aftermarket DNA-based technology just equally can do well. A lot of other research groups are doing. We made a strategic choice that we actually are focusing on small molecule detection because we think that is a scientific and technology gap that other methods has not been capable of doing well, particularly antibodies. So we actually started doing that. So hopefully, just give you a few examples, the interest. So we're able to select out DNA sequences for like a small molecule like the metal ones. You can see they all have a very similar general structure like this. So we use a part of the reason because we use the same selection, we just fit in different type of metal line to it. They all have the same kind of reactivity, but yet slightly different sequences that give you selectivity. Right, I'll show you how selective they are in just a couple minutes. And why do we use the functional DNA? It was not obvious, the first choice, particularly for detecting metalline, because we all know DNA have a phosphate. It binds metalline automatically. In fact, when we proposed this one at the beginning, a lot of people thought we were crazy because, of course, phosphate will bind metalline. How can you have a selective binding to the metalline? It will bind metalline for sure, but how do you have a selectivity? And part of the reason is because, again, as I mentioned, we believe just like the proteins, you have a form of three-dimensional pocket fold. But also, another reason also people do not think of DNA as also sensing material, either because people already think of organic molecule proteins, but they're equally environmentally benign, cost effective, but more importantly, DNA is also quite stable versus antibody, for example. And they're much more stable than proteins. And also, also people forget that the DNA that we're talking about are no longer single-stranded random conformation DNA. We're talking about something like proteins have a global shapes. These are the functional DNA shapes. And then they're also quite stable to resist to degradation. But one thing I also mentioned, I know a lot of people are interested, it's not recombinant DNA either. In other words, it does not replicate itself like recombinant DNA. It's a small piece of DNA, just does not do much replication at all because there's no original replication. Another big thing is also the size. This is the antibody I put on the scale of the functional DNA. It's much smaller, therefore not only cheaper, but also if you want to put on surfaces, the density, if you want to say, is much, much higher versus antibody. Not only stable, but another thing also the denaturation. As you know, a lot of molecules, particular protein molecules, has all this problem of so-called void X syndrome. When you void X, it denatures, it cannot come back. But DNA, RNA, on the other hand, you can denature many times without any problem. So it's very important for manufacturing process. You can manufacture the DNA with that to it. You can go through the heating, cooling, organic, doesn't matter. But once you get back to normal physiological condition, after you've done your manufacturing process, they go back to this original active state. That's not going to happen usually in antibody cases. It's also non-immunogenic. A lot of antibody when you humanize it, because if you make antibody from animals, you cannot use directly in human because there's immunogenic problems. DNRNA does not have a problem. Can be readily modified. I'll show you a couple examples. For single transduction, unlike proteins, it's not very easy to modify. It also can be genetically engineered to do specific locations. So many, many advantages that becoming apparent once we start working on it. So I hope I convinced you now I have a general method, just as good, maybe even better, like antibodies in terms of timing of different molecules for a target. But there's still a problem in terms of activity. How can you make it selective? That actually is what facing the field for many, many years. Well, the problem again, this is just to give you an example, this is what everyone wants. That's a target. We have a grant from the NIH, for example, one detect cobalt, carcinogen, and this is everyone wants. But most of the time people end up doing is they get a molecule that not only find cobalt but something else. So what do you end up doing then? The majority of people in the field is what they do, they have to publish work. The student has to graduate. So they say instead of having a sensor for target A, I have sensor for target B. Okay, and that actually happened quite often, and in fact in my own life too. We have to solve this problem instead to make it more general. So this actually a real example happened every in the laboratory, and including my own lab. And this was a problem. This particular technology is not immune to the problem. We have a grant from NIH. We hope, we promised to develop a sensor for cobalt. We did the whole selection, right? And then we end up with a DNA that does work with cobalt. But unfortunately, it worked with zinc and lead even better. For inorganic chemistry audience, you know it's not surprising because a cobalt zinc looks much, much alike. Same charge, same ion radii, very similar preference for ligand donors, that just slightly different preference for geometry. And lead is also known to be able to cleave DNA very well. So we have to solve this problem in order to be different, in order to make sure that we have a general method to have a selectivity. Or else, we will not be able to deliver on what we promised. But one nice thing about this is we have not only one molecule, we have a group of molecules all the time. That's quite different for the combinatorial biology selection versus regular DNA sensor designs. When regular sensor design, they only have one or few molecules to begin with. And then when that molecule doesn't work, does not have a selectivity, then go all the way back to the beginning to redesign it. But for ours, we have a population here. Initial population is 10 to the 15 different sequences. We do end up with smaller populations, but that population is still more than a few thousand, even tens of thousands. So what we can do then, we add a negative selection step. So if we do normal selection, for example, cobalt selection, we do end up with DNA with high cobalt activity, but unfortunately low selectivity, as I showed you earlier, bind zinc and lead cobalt even better. How do we improve that? We can add a negative selection using statistics on our site. We can add a lead and zinc to remove the population that work with competing metals. In principle then, we should end up with only the one that binds to the cobalt, and then with high cobalt activity and selectivity. That's again, using statistics on our site, we have more than just a few molecules, we have many of them. So that's what we're able to demonstrate. You can see now we have improved the activity, but more importantly, decrease of competing activity. So why is it methods general? Because as long as we know what competing metal is, we can always add this particular competing analytes. It doesn't have to be metal, but other things too. Then we're able to improve that. We can always get higher selectivity than what we can do with negative selection. This is one step, negative selection, we can add multiple steps. Okay? So now we convince you we have a general method to not only obtain molecules that bind to the target, we have a general method to improve the selectivity, but now having that is only a halfway down. We have to be able to convert something that can easily translate into something one can see with eyes or portable equipment. And in fact, that has been people stuck in this one for many, many years. As I mentioned, in the early 1990s, people have collected these beautiful DNA, RNA molecules bind to the target. But the sensing actually did not occur until we got into the field in 2000. Part of the reason because people struggle with this idea, how to turn that DNA, RNA into something one can see the signal transduction. And in fact, there's a few papers published ahead of us, and using the so-called trial and error process, and using very well-known, actually, methodology called replacement technology. What they do, they take the DNRNA, they crystallize it, they know where the binding site is. Right, so know this is binding only selected for this shape or not other shape. That's the step number one. Step number two, then to put a chromophore or fluorophore to the binding site so that it can actually occupy, have a different environment, have a different color and different fluorescent intensity. And then what happened, they're hoping happened that when this lenalidine bind, it will kick out this particular fluorophore chromophore so that it will be able to have different signal changes. It sounds very good, right? In fact, it's been a lot successful. But the problem is the trial and error process. Number one, you had to get a crystal structure. A lot of those DNRNA, for some reason, people still don't know. We still don't have a crystal structure, despite a lot of people's effort. Part of it because it's very small and not very easy to crystallize. Another problem is also that they actually demonstrated in a couple papers before us is that you have to be careful. If you put a chromophore too close to here, this chromophore itself is a large organic molecule. As you all know, fluorophore, fluorescein, for example, very many different aromatic rings. So therefore, the shape of this particular molecular recognition will be different. Therefore, you lose the selectivity. It will not bind to this one anymore, want something that's smaller and different shape. You lose selectivity. So people have demonstrated that. But then recognize that might be a problem. They say, why don't we move this one away from it so it will not perturb the binding? Guess what? It does bind, but the binding site does not translate to some signal transduction. So again, what happened then is a trial and error process. One has to be put closer, but not too close, and the trial and error. So every single sensing project becomes a trial and error process. The success of one particular target will not translate to success for another one. Right? There are, again, some successes, but not general enough. That's the key word, no general methods. So what we decided to do, we had to change the issue because for us to make it more general, something more readily turnkey, we had to be able to use that, something we can actually do this in a much more general way. So what we decided to do, rather than putting fluorophore closer to the binding site, we use a known Watson-Briggs space pair that very well decided in the biology. So what we decided to do, instead of put a fluorophore chromophore here, and we actually put it on the end, but using the known communication module, a very well known in Watson-Briggs phase pair to do sort of signal transductions. So what we did, this is actually a less specific DNA sign that we actually obtained in the laboratory. Instead of putting closer to the site, many people did, we actually put them on a 5' and 3' end. And this is schematic on the top frame like this. We put a 4' here. When we have DNA corresponding now, we have a quencher in there, so we actually want to have a turn-on sensor so that the initial state will be a dark state. Then the hybridization occurs, and then that's in absence of our target. In the presence of our target, you can see the binding here, there's a cleavage here, and then what happened then, there's different melting temperatures. Melting temperature, this one is above room temperature when they cleave, and then this melting temperature in here is below room temperature, so that it will not be stable when it leaves. So we actually have an increase of the fluorescence. So that's the concept. And this is actually the data we can show again. This form number one is a fluorophore by itself. And we'll add a corresponding DNA with another DNA with quencher, you can see a quench state. We'll add a lead to it, you can see dramatic increase of the lead. Okay, and then we can see an increase of fluorescent signal. So we call it Kalita beacon to be different because before us, our work had been going on in using so-called molecular beacon. Many of you probably know that. It's been very popular right now in genetic detection for DNA. And what we have done is actually using Kalita DNA and do Kalita turnovers. There are two differences between our method and the molecular beacon. Number one, molecular beacon only detect nucleic acid, DNRNA, not anything else. For our method, we can detect not only DNRNA, but also many other species, including metabolites, I'll show you, organic molecules, and so on and so forth. But more importantly, we have a Kalita turnovers, we have accumulation of this. So this piece of DNA can bind to another piece of DNA, can actually go to the turnover, can accumulate these species, so have much higher detection sensitivity and lower detection. So this is a demonstration concept. So since then, how to make it general? Because this particular technology, it can be applied to many other different type of species, because we can use it, for example, in lead cases. We have shown that we can detect lead in 1 nanomolar, that's below the maximum contamination level at the 75 nanomolar for drinking water. And we also be able to select using a grant from DOE to be able to get a sensor for uranium with a detection limit of 45 picomolar, something comparable to that antibody. In fact, even better than ICP mass spec. The detection limit ICP mass spec can only detect 420 picomolar. Our sensor particle formation can come to that. Again, all below GPA-MCL. Another thing also, we also have copper and mercury detection. And in fact, this list can go on and on. We can see we can go back, repeat this process, and the similar general structure, we can actually utilize that for detection of many other metabolites. And how about selectivity? All right, so the beautiful thing about the biology is that it's maintained quite strong selectivity. This is an example for selectivity for uranium sensors. So you can see this is a signal for uranium. This is a signal for all the other metabolites we have a surveyed. You can see this may be a little bit misleading because this one is about 10 nanomolar. This is micromolar. So that's a mega thousand-fold differences. So it's over a million-fold selectivity over the next best competitor, and then hundreds of millions to billions-fold of selectivity over the other metabolites we select. Right. So we're not just satisfied having a fluorescent sensor, because fluorescent sensor, yes, you can use a polarimeter, but still, sometimes you want even more convenient detections. Colorimetric sensor is even better because you can many times can use naked eye to do the detection. So we actually took advantage of the same chemical chemistry. All right, instead of having a fluorophore quencher like what we did, we actually, instead of we attach it to a DNA, that can actually hybridize to a DNA functional nanoparticle. The beautiful thing about the nanoparticle has been shown by many other groups, particularly Chad Merkin's lab at Northwestern, shown that when they actually individually present in the distance longer than that diameter, they have a very distinct red color. In fact, this extinct coefficient, the intensity of that, is stronger, at least 100 times stronger than the strongest colored organic dyes. And when we mix together, we can have hybridize it. And beautiful thing about due to the subsurface bottling effect, when the distances between them is comparable to the diameters, they have a very strong blue color. Again, very strong colored blue colors. The distance dependent property is very beautiful. And in the absence of lead, okay, and there are no color changes, but in the present lead, because this chemistry going on, we can actually use the lead to be able to clean. Alright, so we can see the color change from blue to red. Alright, so this is very similar to Merkin technology, but there are two significant differences. Number one, Merkin technology, some of you may know, only detect nucleic acid. Right? They have been applied to protein, but they haven't done some actual work. But most importantly, the Merkin technology required extremely careful temperature, heating, and cooling. Because there, everything depends there, a subtle changes of temperature, 1 degree or 2 degree changes, can make a big difference. That's good in the clinical laboratory, in the hospital, in the controlled air conditioned atmosphere, but does not work very well on-site treatment because you can go to Alaska, go to Texas, the temperature can vary dramatically. Without careful temperature control, the technology does not work. For our technology, we do not depending on melting temperature. Well, we do a little bit, but we have a much wider range of temperature dependence. So this one happened at ambient condition. We're talking about from anywhere from 10 degrees to 30 degrees, no problems. You do not need a careful temperature control. You do need some temperature, but not as much. It can happen, but more importantly, you can detect a wide variety of other types of materials. This is actually visual. You can see, you put on the piece of paper, you can see the color change in front of your eye, something similar to the pH indicators. Right? But if you go back and replace this particular sequences with other sequences, now we have a general method to be able to apply for a detection of a wide range of molecules, in this case, the nanomolar. Okay? So recently, we also be able to apply that to uranium detection, same uranium sequences. Now we can detect uranium down to about 1 nanomolar below the EPA MCL level. Again, this list has been growing every day. All right, so now let me talk about the final challenges. All right, so a lot of work has been going on since we have been able to solve these problems. But you can see a practice sensor for in the field or in the laboratory, part of the reason because of so-called fine-tuning the dynamic range. Why is this important? This is actually a practical issue challenge we were given by HUD. And how it wants it to have a less sensor. Now, don't have a less sensor, we also give a specific one because the federal government, the EPA particularly, have defined the threshold for lead intent to be this, 1 mg per square centimeter, 0.5%. Okay? So in other words, that the inspectors do not expect, not only expect the sensor selected for lead, but also want to expect the sensor changing colors exactly where the threshold is. So that's a high order of requirement. Okay? So you don't have a sensor. So a lot of people, you can see the nature, cover nature science would say, I can detect a single molecule of species. But that's only going to cover nature science, but we rarely can get into the practical uses because most people do not care about detecting single molecule lead. They want to detect lead where it's very low. For example, want to have a drinking water, right? Should I drink it or not? Or you can always tell them there's a one molecule lead. Should you drink it or not, right? But what's more important is whether that lead is at a safe level or not. Do you have a sensor changing signals at exactly the range people care about? And one more for lead is important also for lead in paint is this. And you know lead in water is somewhere here because you drink water, you don't need paint. So how can you have a one sensor? On one hand, you walk into the lab in the home, on one hand, you can detect lead in water, lead in paint, lead in dust, lead in soil. They all have a completely different range. How can you have a technology to be able to do that all in one visit, right? Without changing your technology. But more important, as I said, as you probably know that well, that these thresholds can change depending on the technology, depending on who's in the Congress. Those things can also change, right? So you can spend years of work to change color right here, but the next 4 years later, you have to change your technology, then what, right? So that's really important. So what we have developed, again, go back to the fundamental biology, can we have a tunable dynamic range at anywhere we want it? So that's what we're able to demonstrate. So this is the DNA I showed you earlier. That's actually DNA. We're able to show this GT is also very far. Very interesting. That's a Warburg pair, not regular GC pair. When we change the GT to GC, actually, Andrew Brown did, since the GC, actually, she was able to show it's completely inactive. A single base change completely shut down the activity. And that's why it showed. Jevalu showed that you can, in this one, you can go from blue to red. I showed you earlier. When you see in there, it's completely inactive. Now, the Jevalu came up with the idea, can we actually mix the two together? When you have 100% this, you have a sensitive detection from 1 micromolar to 1 micromolar. You can see very sharp changes. But unfortunately, many sensitive sensors, it loses the dynamic range. It cannot detect anything above this or below this. Right? But when he actually decided mix ratio, because the top strands in here are identical, the bottom strand is different. Okay? So then when it mix 20 fold of this and 1 fold of that, it does do the cleavage and have color change. But yet you require much more lead because this inactive DNA that binds lead but does not cleave. So then we have a 20-fold of this and 1 fold of that, it does have a color change, but it requires much more lead for the same color change to occur. So the sensitivity didn't change, the slope didn't change, but the dynamic range changed from 0.1 to 1 to 10 to 100 micromolar. Okay? But more importantly, this methodology is quite versatile. Well, we don't have to do 20 to 1, we can do 1 to 1, 2 to 1, 5 to 1, 100 to 1. We can pretty much match it where we want it. Right, we can tune that. That's exactly what we're able to show. We can tune the dynamic range. You can see the color from left. That's one color, right to another color. Exactly where the threshold of EPA was. Okay? So let me just wrap up that we have ongoing project. That's the finished project, and we're actually going on with the detection for others. But now actually the project we have funded actually interested in beyond metal line detection, beyond the cleavage. Can we actually use DNA aberrant? So one of the things that we're interested in doing in detecting the toxins. Again, I want to read the list. You know why it's important for detecting the toxins. And this is the structure of the toxins. And actually, work done by Jennifer and Nadini. Jennifer and ICC and Nadini in my lab. We were actually using the selection process. We were able to actually select aptamers that selectively for endotoxins. We're actually pretty pleased that we actually see after 16-1 selection, a lot of hard work, Jennifer. And actually, we'll get some signals for the aptamer for that. So we actually, now actually, can we actually turn this aptamer into something we can do? So we do not have a sensor for endotoxin yet, but just use the example for cocaine, all right? And so the nice thing about this, can we actually have a piece of DNA without cleavage shown earlier, can actually do the selection. The nice thing about this one right here, there's a 12 base pair here. In the presence of, again, room temperature, the melting temperature of this particular one is about 50 degrees Celsius. So it's actually stable aggregate, give you a kind of a faint purple blue color. But in the presence of target cocaine, this one binds to here. So now you receive only 5 base pair here. Now 5 base pair give you a melting temperature below room temperature of about 10 degrees. But what happens then, this one falls apart and give you a distance red color. You can see clearly cocaine color changes in the presence of cocaine. And more importantly, we're able to develop a dipstick test. This is something equivalent to pH paper now. Now we can actually have aggregates put in here. In the absence of a target, there nothing happens, and then negative chemical, nothing happens that here. In the present target, there's a disaggregation. This nanoparticle migrates through capture by the corresponding capturing agent, in this case, a strabavidin with biotin. You can see the color there. You can see now, you can see progression of the color changes, and red colors in the undiluted human surface. And very selectively, it does not run others. So that's our direction. So now we have come up with the aptamer, so we can actually apply to this technology into dipstick test for a wide variety of other molecules. So let me summarize what I talked about today. To obtain the sensor for broad range target, one has to have a general methodology to obtain the sensing molecule, to improve the selectivity, to convert the molecular recognition event into something one can detect, and also more importantly, tune the dynamic range. I hope I convinced you that functional DNA technology is able to do all four. The combination of these one with another technology allows to have a stable, cost-effective sensor, very sensitive, come to picomolar, very selective, meaningful, tunable dynamometers, in my opinion, quite unique. Therefore, can be applied in detecting quantification of many different targets, most importantly, for real-time on-site detection. And I'd like to thank the people who did the work, Dr. Jin Li, who did the first selection of LED sensors, Dr. Zhu Li convert them into conventional sensors, Jin Li turn into a fluorescent sensors. And I'd like to thank the Nandini. Nandini actually was started on the project on the in the toxin selection in collaboration with Jennifer. I also appreciate Kishore for actually starting the whole project, get the ideas going, and appreciate also for the support in terms of advice and also financial support. And the division ISTC also we leverage the funding from STC to other type of funding sources. I'd like to thank them for the funding. I'd like to thank you for your attention.